Okay, so we'll start. Hello, everybody. It is our great pleasure to welcome you today for our first seminar of this year, 2019-2020. Every month, there will be a seminar, a colloquium, given by a distinguished professor or researcher. So today, we have the pleasure to welcome Andreas Meijering from Utrecht University, the Debye Institute of Utrecht University. So you are a former an alumni of Utrecht University, where you had a Master of Science and PhD in chemistry. And after that, you made a postdoc at Madison, University of Wisconsin, and you returned. You went back to Utrecht University after that. And since 1991, you are the chair of solid-state chemistry of the Utrecht University at the Debye Institute. So you lead a research team, an active research team in the domain of, in the field of luminescence spectroscopy. Your research has given you much fame, really. If I want to give your H factor, you have 79 H factor, and you received the gold medal of the Royal Dutch Society of Chemistry. And since 2009, you have been elected to the Royal Dutch Academy of Sciences. So it is a real pleasure to welcome you today. I would like to give you now the talk. Thank you.
Thank you for the kind introduction. And also thanks to Thierry and Jung-Wook and Zijun for arranging this visit. Zijun being a former PhD student, it's very nice to see him here thrive in Paris. So today, I will discuss rare earths for sustainable earths. It will be a more general talk. I'd like to introduce you to the very unique properties of lanthanide ions, of rare earth ions, discuss applications for sustainable applications on the earth, and then I will focus on optical properties, which is my specialty. But before I do that, it's maybe also nice to know where I'm from and where Utrecht is, and what's nice about Utrecht. So Utrecht is in this small country, the Netherlands, at the tip of the blue arrow. Utrecht University is the biggest university in the Netherlands. We're just a bit bigger than Amsterdam University. And we also think we're the best university in the Netherlands. We have about 30,000 students in all disciplines, science, humanities, biomedical, social sciences. During the history of our university, 12 Nobel Prize winners have worked at Utrecht University. And we still have one active Nobel Prize winner in physics, Gerard het Hooft. You're high on all those lists, whatever, well, that's worse. The Dom Tower is the symbol of Utrecht. It's the biggest tower in the Netherlands, the highest tower. And right next to the Dom Tower, we have our beautiful academy building, where we have all nice official ceremonies related to the university. That's in the city center, and outside the city center, we have the university campus, and not as nice as this building, but very functional is our laboratory, the Ornstein Laboratory in my room is right there. So what I will do today? I will give an introduction to rare earths, explain what rare earths are, why they're special. Then I will discuss some applications of rare earths for sustainability, sustainable applications. And then I will focus on light-emitting materials, spectroconversion of rare earths. I will give an overview of all different applications where you can find rare earth ions to emit light. I will explain how fluorescent tubes and complex fluorescent tubes work. I will explain white light LEDs, displays, solar cells. Not an important money, and it will end with conclusions. And then if there's time, there will be also be a chemistry. So first, rare earth. Rare earth is defined as the group of the lanthanides in the periodic table plus the elements scandium and yttrium. And the word lanthanide comes from the Greek word lanthanein, which means to lie hidden. And in the periodic table, this is the group of the lanthanides, and indeed it's a bit hidden at the bottom of the periodic table. It's a group of elements where an inner four F shell is filled with electrons. When I was in high school, we learned how the different shells are filled with electrons in the periodic table, and first electrons go according to the Aufbauprinzip in the 1s orbital, then the 2s orbital, the 2p3s orbital, the 3p4s, 3d4p5s, 4d5p6s, and only after the outer orbitals 5s, 5p, and 6s are filled with electrons, only then the inner 4f shell is filled with electrons. And the group of elements where this inner 4f shell is filled with electrons, those are the lanthanides. going from lanthanum, which has an empty 4F shell, to lutetium, where the 4F shell is filled with 14 electrons. And this partly filled inner 4F shell, that gives the lanthanides unique optical magnetic properties. So they're called rare earths, and then you might think that they are rare, and also because they're not very well known, people think they are rare. But in fact, the rare earths are not rare. They're quite common. If you look at the abundance of the different elements as a function of atomic number, then we see that the most common elements are oxygen and silicon. They're quite common in the earth. But the lanthanides here are quite common, very similar to the transition metal ions. If you look at the most abundant of the lanthanides, that's cerium, it's number 29 of the list of most common elements, 65 ppm in the Earth's crust, comparable to copper or zinc. Not rare at all. The least abundant, so the rarest of the rare earths, is thulium, but that still has 0.2 ppm, two times more than silver or cadmium. The really rare elements are the 4D and the 5D transition metal elements like iridium, platinum, gold, osmium, palladium, rhodium, ruthenium. Those are the really rare elements. So the rare earths are not rare. They're quite common. There's a lot of them around. So they're hidden elements. But since some years, they're not as hidden anymore. The lanthanides, and I will explain that in a bit more detail later, are mined mainly in China. And about 9 years ago, China decided to limit the export of the rare earths, and then the world noticed the importance of the rare earths. Before that, people didn't realize that most of the light and artificial light sources is all coming from rare earths, that in the magnets, it's only the strong magnets all contain rare earths. But when China decided to limit the export, then the price increased 20-fold, 50-fold, and people were worried about the application. So then in the news, my Dutch newspaper, the magazine of the Dutch Chemical Association, CNN, everybody was talking about the rare earths. And since then, more people know about them. So they're not rare. They're not as much hidden as they used to be, but they are unique. And the unique properties come from this partly filled 4F shell. And I try to explain the optical properties and the magnetic properties to give you some idea where they come from. So if you look at one of the example, terbium 3 plus, it has a partly filled 4F shell and it has 8 electrons in the 4F shell. There are 7 F orbitals, and in every F orbital you can have 2 electrons, one with spin up, one with spin down, so there's 14 positions for those F electrons. And the number of ways you can arrange 8 electrons over 14 orbitals is 14 over 8. 14 faculty divided by 14 minus 8 faculty times 8 faculty. And that is 3,003 different ways. So there's 3,003 different arrangements of those 8 F electrons over 14 F orbitals. And all 3,003 different arrangements can have a different energy. And that gives lanthanides a very rich energy level structure, which gives them their unique optical properties. The lowest energy state, we can determine that as Hund's rule, it's the ground state. That's the state in which, as much as possible, the electrons have their spin moments aligned. So if you have 8 electrons, we can put in the 7 F orbitals, 7 F electrons with their spin up. Then the 8th electron cannot also have its spin up, then the Pauli principle would be violated. We don't want to do that, so the 8th electron goes in the orbital with the highest angular momentum. So this is one of the 3,003 configuration. It's the one with the lowest energy. But then there's still 3,002 other configurations which can have higher energies, and that gives lanthanides their unique optical properties and also their magnetic properties, because you may notice that we have a lot of electron spins aligned. So the ground state, where the terbium ion is in, has a very high magnetic moment. So if you look at the magnetic properties, this magnetic material, neodymium iron boride, was discovered in the mid-80s, and that's those very strong magnets, you may know them, much higher remnant magnetization than the traditional magnets based on transition metal ions, and those magnets with a very high Curie temperature and a very high magnetic moment are widely applied now, for example, in windmills, wind turbines. Optical properties. They arise from the different electrical configurations. I mentioned the ground state. As much as possible, all the electron spins aligned in the same way, and here paired. And those electronic configurations of the lanthanides with different energies are labeled by so-called term symbols. Not important to understand what they mean. It's a term symbol, just a name for an energy level, and the ground state has a term symbol 7F6. So for terbium, the ground state is this electronic configuration that belongs to the term symbol 7F6. So that is the lowest energy state. But then there's 3,002 other configurations, and they can all have higher energies. So there's many energy levels at higher energies where the 8 electrons are arranged in a slightly less favorable way. For example, this way, here we see the 5d4, the configuration that belongs to the 5d4 state. Now we have 6 electrons with the spin up and 2 with the spin paired. And according to Hund's rules, 6 up, 2 down is a higher energy than 7 up and 1 down. And typically we plot those energy levels as a function of energy. We have all the different term symbols, all the different energy states, and for terbium you see 7F6 ground state, and here is that 5D4 excited state, then it's a 5D3 state, and many, 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 many more states, all the way up to 170,000 wave numbers. So a very rich energy level structure. When we excite terbium, for example, in the UV, we excite from the ground state 7F6 to the 5D3 excited state, that corresponds to a photon in the UV around 360 nanometers, and the terbium relaxes down by giving off its energy to phonons, lattice vibrations to the 5D4 state. Now from this 5D4 state, you get very efficient emission. The quantum efficiency is very close to 100%. That means that if the terbium ion absorbs 100 UV photons, close to 100 visible photons are emitted at longer wavelengths at lower energy. This is the emission spectrum of the terbium. And in that spectrum, you can see some of the very typical characteristics of lanthanide luminescence. It's quite unique for an ion in a solid to give sharp line emission. Usually, molecules and ions in solids give broadband emission, but the lanthanides have very sharp line emission. The reason is that those transitions occur within this partly filled 4F shell that is shielded by the filled 5S and the 5P shell from the environment. So the coupling with lattice vibration is very weak because transitions in this inner shell that hardly feels the environment. So very sharp lines. And you see here in the emission spectrum the 5D4 to 7F6 emission, where you go from the excited 5D4 state all the way down to 7F6, corresponding to photons in the blue-green region, around 490 nanometers. Very efficient green emission due to the 5D4 to 7F5 transition, around 550 nanometers, and some 5D4 to 7F4 emission, around 590 nanometers. So atomic-like, sharp line emission. Also, again, because of the shielding by the environment, independent of the environment, whether terbium is in a fluorite host crystal, an oxide host crystal, or sulfide, doesn't matter. Those energy levels are always the same because they're determined by the interaction between the electrons in this partly filled 4F orbital, and there's no interaction with the environment. And as I mentioned, the quantum yield can be very high, typically over 90%. And that's the reason that they're used very widely in all kinds of light-emitting devices. Now, if you look at applications where the lanthanides are used because of their sustainable properties, you can find them for energy production. The magnets in wind turbines, I will show a picture later, typically rely on the very high remnant magnets, which have a higher magnetization than traditional magnets, and that means that the production of energy is about 30% more efficient than with the traditional magnets. And also in the hybrid cars, the same magnets are used to convert rotational energy into electrical energy. And possibly they can also be used for spectral conversion for solar cells to make solar cells more efficient. And I will discuss that later in the talk. They're in batteries. Lanthanum is in energy storage batteries. Energy saving catalysts based on cerium are very efficient. And energy efficient lighting, compact fluorescent tubes, LED lighting, all rely on efficient emission of lanthanides. And then there's also many other applications, military applications, lasers, radar sensors, radiation detectors, communication. Very important for the army. So very high-tech applications are also based on those unique optical properties of this partly filled 4F shell. Wind turbines. You see a picture of a wind turbine with a huge 300 kilograms neodymium iron boride magnet. All those new wind turbines that are placed in the sea and the land contain a lot of lanthanides, a lot of neodymium. Same in hybrid cars. In a hybrid car, there's typically 10 to 15 kilos of lanthanides in them. So it's good that they're not rare because they're widely used. We really need them. If you look at the demand and the use of rare earths over time, then until about 1965, they were hardly used. In 1965, the first applications came and the lanthanides were mainly mined in the United States, California, the Mountain Pass mine, big mine, California, where they mined the rare earths. But then starting in 1985, China started to produce rare earths much cheaper than we can do it in the West, partly because the environmental considerations are less important in China than in the West, so they can produce rare earths very cheaply, and you see that the Mountain Pass mine was closed, and also mines in Australia were closed, and now 95% of production is from China. So China really controls rare earth markets. That's a rather unique situation that one country has such a dominant position in a group of very important elements. If you look at the use of rare earths, where they're used now, magnets is an increasing part. They're used as alloys, so they're added to metals to make them stronger, to give them special properties. They're used for polishing, they're added to glass to increase the refractive index. They're used as catalysts, mainly cerium in ceramics, and what I will talk about today, phosphors, luminescent materials that are able to convert invisible radiation, UV radiation, gamma radiation, into visible light. So luminescent materials that are capable of efficiently emitting visible light are called phosphors, and about 5% of the rare earth market concerns phosphors. So that brings me to my specialty, spectral conversion, light conversion with lanthanides. And before I do that, it's always good to look a bit in the history. I will do that several times during talks. Good to look back to see where we came from, and in the end, I will also look where we're going. So a short history of lighting. It started all with the sun, and the sun emits perfect white light. And the sun emits white light because it's a black body radiator. That may seem a strange name for an object that we say emits perfect white light, but the sun emits light because it's hot. And you may know the phenomenon when you make an iron bar, you make it, put it in the fire, it gets red hot. When you make it even hotter, it becomes white. And the spectrum that the hot object emits depends on the temperature, in case of a black body radiator. And in this plot, the blue curve is the spectrum that the sun emits because the sun has a temperature of 6,000 Kelvin. And any object of a temperature of 6,000 Kelvin emits this spectrum. We see it's a broad spectrum, wavelengths from 200 nanometers to beyond 1,500 nanometers. Part of the spectrum we can see, the ooggevoeligheid, the eye sensitivity, Dutch word, spectrum response is given here. In the eye, there's receptors, organic molecules, that can detect light with wavelengths between 400 and 700 nanometers. And every wavelength has its own color, 420 nanometers violet, 450 nanometers blue, 520 nanometers green, 570 yellow, 590 orange, and beyond 600 nanometers we have red light. So that's perfect, but the sun has one problem. At night the sun sets. So also since prehistoric times, people have been trying to make light when it was dark. That started probably about 800,000 BC when people made fires. It was nice and warm and it gave light, but it's not very energy efficient. Control of the light emitting sources became better with the oil lamp, the candle, the gas lamp, the carbon arc lamp. But all those light sources have an energy efficiency that is less than 1%. And the energy efficiency I define as the amount of energy that is in the photons that are emitted by the light source in the visible part of the spectrum, divided by all the energy you have to put in to generate that light. And then you can understand that you're making a fire, you use a lot of energy, and there's not that much light coming out. A big step forward was in 1879, when Edison invented the incandescent lamp. This is a picture of the incandescent lamp as it looked like in the time of Edison. It consisted of an evacuated glass bulb. You can still see where it was evacuated. And in that vacuum, there was a carbon wire. And when you turn on the voltage, when you plug it in, then electric current starts to flow through the carbon wire. It has a resistance. The carbon wire gets hot. It gets glowing hot and starts to emit light. And the energy efficiency is still quite low, but it's better than from the old light source, about 2 to 3%. The temperature of the carbon wire, and in present incandescent lamps it's a tungsten wire, but the temperature is not very different, is about 3,000 Kelvin. And then we also have a black body spectrum, and the black body spectrum that any object of 3,000 Kelvin emits is plotted here in the red curve. You see for a lower temperature, the maximum of the emission is at a longer wavelength, the lower energy photon, it's around 1,000 nanometers, and that's picture shows you immediately why the efficiency of incandescent lamps is so low. This is the part of the spectrum we can see. That's just the tail of the blackbody spectrum of an object of 3,000 Kelvin. Most of the energy is emitted as infrared radiation that we cannot see. Radiation with a wavelength longer than 700 nanometers. That's my driving license. I took the exam 10 times, so I'm rather proud that I finally got it. I have very patient parents. They paid for my driving lessons. That's not the reason that I'm showing it. The reason I'm showing it is my birth date is on there. I was born on December 21st. And December 21st is the shortest day of the year. It's only light for about 6 hours. And the year I was born, 1963, it was all incandescent lamps. So when I was born, I must have thought, it's pretty dark. And the way we make light is not efficient. I can do better. So I was predestined to work on light emitting materials. And the way to make light more efficiently is using a very general phenomenon called luminescence. Luminescence is a very general phenomenon that you generate emission of visible light under high energy excitation, UV radiation, X-ray excitation. And well, the most simple picture that they also use for high school students, so don't be offended that I also use it here, but it is good to understand the principles, are electronic transitions. Again, the ground state of an ion is the configuration where electrons are closest possible to the nucleus, have the least repulsion between each other. But then there's many empty orbitals, higher energy states, where the electrons can go. And in a luminescent material, luminescent ion, you can excite your ion from the ground state to a high excited state, where the electron is very far away from the nucleus, then can go to a lower energy excited state by losing some of its energy. And from this lower energy excited state, can return to the ground state, emitting a photon of a lower energy than the absorbed UV photon, for example, in the red or the green or the blue spectral region. So luminescent materials rely on luminescent ions or luminescent molecules, and we call that a phosphor. Not to be confused with the element phosphor. A phosphor is a luminescent material that is capable of converting invisible high-energy radiation into visible light, and preferably do that quite efficiently. Luminescence is a general name for fluorescence, which is fast emission. When you remove the excitation source, the light immediately is dying out. And when you have phosphorescence, you can see a little bit of afterglow. After you remove the excitation source, you still see a little bit of afterglow. But both are called luminescence. Now, if you look at the periodic table, here in the grayish-green boxes, all the elements are indicated that at some point in history have been used in light-emitting devices. Displays, lamps, X-ray imaging, and then you see there's some 3D transition metal ions, some 4D, some 5D S-squared ions, but the champions among the luminescent ions, which are also called activators, are the lanthanides. From cerium to ytterbium, almost all lanthanides have been used in some type of luminescent device, and they're the most efficient luminescent materials. Again, a bit of history is always good to go back. So how did it start with the lanthanides? Well, actually, I think it may have started in the École Polytechnique, because I think Becquerel worked at the École Polytechnique. So it started all with you. In 1908, Becquerel was looking at rare earth salts, and Becquerel observed, rather peculiarly, he saw those rare earth salts have very sharp absorption lines. And as I mentioned, usually materials have broad absorption bands, broad emission bands. Becquerel looked at rare earth salts and he saw very sharp lines. Very strange. And he published that, but did not understand it. So he called it the puzzle of the lanthanides, or the puzzle of the rare earths. It took 30 years until Van Vleck solved the puzzle, and he showed that those very sharp absorption lines correspond to transitions for different electronic states within this partly filled for F shell. So they are FF transitions. They are formally forbidden because you go from a ground state, for example, 8 electrons in the 4F shell, to an excited state, where those 8 electrons are slightly different arranged, but you still have the same electronic configuration, which means that there's no change of dipole moment, so those transitions are formally parity forbidden, but Van Vleck identified that those selection rules can be lifted and that those sharp absorption lines were FF transitions, transitions within the partly filled 4F shell of the different lanthanides. And then in the 1960s, a lot of very good fundamental work was done by Brian Jurt, Brian Weibern, Gerard Dieke, Bill Canal, they developed a theory to calculate all those energy levels of the lanthanides and also calculate the transition probabilities when the absorptions were a bit stronger or weaker and how the emission spectra looked like. So very good fundamental work in the 1960s. And that has resulted now in many applications. And this is not even a complete list. Lanthanide luminescence is used in fluorescent tubes, compact fluorescent tubes. We'll discuss that. White light LEDs, displays, plasma display panels, liquid crystal displays, scintillators, X-ray imaging. So when you go to the hospital, lanthanide will be used to make those beautiful pictures. Afterglow materials, like you see here, which in the dark continue to emit light. Lasers, fiber amplifiers. Erbium ions amplify the signals in fiber amplifiers in the ocean every 10 kilometers. Those digital signals that go to our fiber connectors for the computer signals are amplified by erbium ions, solar cells, and more. The red ones I will discuss. First, fluorescent tubes. Fluorescent tube is a glass tube. In the glass tube, there's a little bit of mercury. When you turn on the fluorescent tube, the mercury evaporates, and then you pass current through the mercury gas. The electrons collide with the mercury atoms. The mercury atoms go into a high excited state, so the electrons go from an orbital close to the nucleus to an orbital a bit far from the nucleus, and then the mercury returns to the ground state, emitting UV radiation. The efficiency of the process is quite high, about 70%. So if you pass 10 watts of electrical current through a mercury gas, 7 watts of UV radiation comes out. But you cannot see it. So what you need to do is apply phosphors, luminescent materials, on the inside of the glass wall that absorbs UV radiation and converts it into visible light. In the modern fluorescent tubes, all those phosphors are the most efficient materials based on lanthanides. The red phosphor, itrium oxide europium-3+. Europium-3+ absorbs to 254 nanometers and emits nice red light. The green phosphor is lanthanum phosphate with cerium and terbium. Cerium absorbs UV radiation, transfers energy to terbium, and terbium emits efficient green light. And the blue phosphor is barium magnesium luminate with europium-2+. That emits nice blue light, and if you mix those, and the ratio is 2 scoops of red, 2 scoops of green, 1 scoop of blue, you mix it nicely, then you get a nice white light emitting material. These are the spectra that those phosphors emit. And then one thing you may notice is that it's very different from the solar spectrum. The solar spectrum was broadband at all wavelengths from 400 to 700 nanometers, nice flat spectrum. The fluorescent tubes, some sharp lines in the red, some sharp lines in the green, rather narrowband in the blue. And that means that the spectrum is quite different from the solar spectrum. So if you want to judge a color, the color under fluorescent tube light may be very different than in sunlight. So in good clothes stores or in musea, you will not see fluorescent tubes because the color rendering of fluorescent tubes can be quite a bit worse than for incandescent lamps or more broadband emitting light sources. There's also very special fluorescent tubes where they added a lot of the red phosphor, the itrium oxide europium. They had butchers and are put above the meat. Those fluorescent tubes, UV radiation is converted by itrium oxide to a lot of red light. The red light hits the meat reflects the red light, and you see nice fresh meat. Butcher is very happy. But in fact, you see europium-3+ emission. So fluorescent tubes and compact fluorescent tubes are no different. The compact fluorescent tube is the same principle, glass tube, but now it's curved, it's bent. But glass tube, mercury in, you turn it on, the current starts passing the mercury. Mercury emits UV radiation, and the phosphors in the inside of a glass tube convert it into visible light. Those light sources are light sources of the past. They're rather efficient, but they're clumsy, they're big. And the future of lighting is white light LEDs. And that already was predicted in the 1960s. It started with the invention of the blue LED. It's an invention that was done in the late 80s, early 90s by 3 Japanese scientists, Akasaki, Amano, and Nakamura. They discovered the blue LED, the blue light emitting diode. Before that, already in the 60s and 70s, we had red LEDs, green LEDs. You may just notice as little indicator lights on your electronics. And that's nice, and they were long-lived, and especially the red ones could be quite efficient. But to make white light, the invention of the blue LED was a great discovery, because blue light has the highest energy photons. And it's quite easy to convert blue photons of high energy to photons in the green, yellow, orange, or red of lower energy. So once you have a blue LED, and you convert part of that blue light into green, yellow, orange, and red light, you can make a white light source. You cannot do it with a green LED. When you have a green LED, you can make yellow and red light, but from green, you cannot go up in energy to blue light, at least not efficiently. So this discovery of the efficient blue LED was a great step forward, and it was recognized in 2014 by the Nobel Committee for the invention of efficient blue light emitting diodes, which has enabled bright and energy-saving white light sources. So how does it work, white light LED? In a white light LED, there's a very small LED, indium gallium nitride LED. That was the material that those three Japanese scientists discovered. It's very small, it's only a millimeter by a millimeter. It's a tiny little LED. And if you apply a voltage to the LED, it very efficiently converts the electrical energy into blue light, wavelengths of 450 nanometers. That blue LED is combined with a yellow phosphor initially, the first white light LED, YAG cerium, yttrium, lumen, GaN, and dopus cerium 3+. Part of the blue light is absorbed by the phosphor and converted into yellow light. Part of the blue light is transmitted, and the spectrum that is then emitted by the white light LED consists of blue light from the LED and a broad yellow emission band from the cerium 3+ ion, and that gives white light. That is rather cool white light, yellow and blue, but you lack emission in the red. So in modern warm white LEDs, people have invented many new phosphors, for example, red-emitting phosphors that can be added to make warmer white light. This is the cerium phosphor, and probably all of you have that with you. Your mobile phone, if you look at the back, there's those little LED flashlights that you can use. And I have a little violet LED here. If I excite from this side, you can also see the emission. You see an orange spots. That's the orange emitting material. So all of you have probably in your mobile phone those phosphors. This is europium 2+ based phosphor, and also the cerium is in there. You may also know it from those nice lamps where you see the yellow spots. This is the YAG cerium phosphor. This is on those white light LED lamps, so you can see it here inside. Those are the yellow phosphors, and here you see an orange phosphor. That's the europium 2+ phosphor. So they are all around now. The reason that white light LEDs are so widely used and are really conquering and are a revolution in lighting is that they are efficient. Efficiency is more than 70 lumens per watt, sometimes even now more than 120 lumens per watt, and the efficiency of a light-emitting device is usually defined in lumens per watt, where the lumen is a measure for the number of photons emitted, corrected for the eye sensitivity curve. So photons emitted in the maximum of the eye sensitivity in the green give more lumens. When you go to the deep red or the violet, you get less lumens per photon. But the energy efficiency of a lamp is indicated in lumens per watt. To compare, the white light LEDs now have 120, even 150 lumens per watt. Fluorescent tubes typically have about 100 lumens per watt. And an incandescent lamp has only 15 lumens per watt. They're compact, and that's a big advantage over the fluorescent tubes. They're very small, so you can make all kinds of lamps like here. You can have many LEDs on a string and then add the phosphor, so you can make any shape and size with those very small 1 millimeter blue LEDs. And also quite important, the lifetime is very long, about 30,000 hours or more. Incandescent lamp lasts only 1,000 hours, fluorescent tube 10,000 hours, white light LEDs more than 30,000 hours. So presently already half the market is in LEDs, LED integrated and replacement LED, and the prediction is that by 2022 about 75 or 70% of the lighting market will be LED lighting. Still many developments, many new developments with LED lighting. There's still different ways of making light. You can have a blue LED and a PC yellow. That means not politically correct, but phosphor-converted yellow. So you have a yellow phosphor. can have blue LED and phosphor converted green and red, so that you have the blue light from the LED, a green emitting phosphor, and a red emitting phosphor that are excited by the blue light. There's also rather efficient UV LEDs, and you can have a blue, a green, and a red phosphor. And also there's a tendency to go from LED pump light sources to diode laser pumped light sources. And with those diode laser pump light sources, you can have most of those really directional light sources, like this monster truck where you have a white light LED pumped by a diode laser that emits light over a kilometer long. Human-centric lighting is an important development where you can make any kind of spectrum by combining the blue LED with different types of phosphors. You can really manipulate the spectrum to a spectrum that is good for people, that makes you healthy, or that you don't get tired by emitting the color of light that keeps you awake at night. So that's an emerging market, and for that, many new phosphors are being investigated. Narrowband emitters are important, where you have narrowband red, narrowband green phosphors, oxygen nitride, nitrates, quantum dots, manganese, many developments in new phosphors. That is in lighting, but also in displays, white light LEDs are used. If you look at how your display works, of your mobile phone or your big display of your computer or the screen at home, there's a liquid crystal display does not make light. A liquid crystal display transmits light of certain colors at different points of your screen. So what you need with a liquid crystal display is a light source, a white light source. And presently, almost all liquid crystal displays use white light LEDs as the light source. So either at the edge or over the whole square, you have white light LEDs. The white light from the white light LEDs made nice and diffuse and coupled light to the front. Then that white light goes into your liquid crystal display. And the liquid crystal display consists of two polarization filters. One polarization filter that transmits this polarization direction, and one polarization filter that transmits this polarization direction. And if you don't do anything, the white light comes in, those polarizations are stopped, but this polarization direction gets through, but then that polarization direction is blocked by this polarization filter, and it's black. So that's a black point on your display. Between those two polarization filters, you have a polarizing field for this direction, here for this direction. Between those, you have a liquid crystal. And liquid crystal is a large organic molecule that has the property that when you put a voltage on a certain point, that liquid crystal starts to organize itself in a nice helix. And in that helix, and the thickness is chosen such, that in that helix, the polarization direction of the light is transformed by exactly 90 degrees. So the white light, this polarization comes in. If you have applied the voltage, then you can very locally, with a 10 micrometer size, apply a voltage with a thin film transistor at any point of your liquid crystal. At all the points where you apply the voltage, liquid crystal organized in a helix, light comes in with this polarization direction. Now, because there's this helix, polarization direction is rotated by 90 degrees, and now it can come out. And every point, there's either a blue, a red, or a green filter. Just by applying a voltage at a certain point, at certain context, behind your liquid crystal, you can make that in your screen, either red light, green light, or blue light is transmitted, or nothing, if you want a black spot. That may be also nice to demonstrate. This is my mobile phone. So what comes out here of the mobile phone is polarized light. So the light rotated comes out through a filter, a color filter, red, green, or blue. If I have a polarization filter in front of it, now the light gets through. But if I rotate the polarization filter 90 degrees, it turns black. So out of your mobile phone comes polarized light. And you can block it by a very simple, cheap polarization filter. Which also means if you have Polaroid glasses on, you may not see your screen as well as without Polaroid glasses. So every pixel in your mobile phone or in the liquid crystal display looks like this. You have the backlight from the LEDs, the white light goes through a polarization filters and a thin film transistor array can put a voltage at every point of your liquid crystal to rotate the polarization rector behind a blue, a green, or a red filter. And if you open your mobile phone, if it's broken, you can also see those white light LEDs. They're here on the edge of, for example, an iPod. Now, if you look at the lighting market, we can see that the lighting market has really changed very rapidly, even more rapidly than the lighting market for displays. You can see that in 2004, only 50 years ago, about 80% of all the televisions that were sold were CRTs, cathode ray tubes, those big, bulky televisions with the electric gun in the back. 5 years later, in 2009, the market was dominated by LCDs, liquid crystal displays, where the backlight was a CCFL, a cold compact contact fluorescent tube. So this was a very thin fluorescent tube with this rare earth phosphorus that emitted the white light. And then 5 years later, in 2014, the market is dominated by LCDs, where the backlight was not a cold cathode fluorescent tube, but a white light LED. So very rapid changes, and it seems like that for now we'll be stuck with the LED backlight LCDs for a while. There's challenges in phosphor research. Those filters emit a rather narrow spectrum in the red or the green. So if you can make phosphors that emit a rather narrow band rather than a broad emission band, you can increase the efficiency of the displays. So that's one of the big challenges in the field of phosphor research, and also our group. We're looking for new narrowband red and new narrowband green phosphors. A future application, solar cells. We have to go to a sustainable society. The fossil fuels will at some point phase out, and then we need alternative energy sources. And solar cells are a very promising, and I think will in the future be the most important source for energy. If you look at the efficiency of solar cells, sometimes people think that nature does everything more efficiently than mankind. And nature is indeed very efficient in many aspects, but not in harvesting solar energy. If you look at the efficiency with which plants harvest energy from sunlight, if you take the amount of energy that's in the photons that impede on a plant, and how much energy of those photons is really stored in biomass, it's typically less than 0.1%. If you work really hard, perfect conditions, give a lot of water and fertilizers, it can be maybe 0.5%, but not more. So plants are not efficient in harvesting solar energy, which also means that biomass will never be capable of replacing fossil fuels as energy source. Solar cells, on the other hand, like silicon solar cells, have efficiencies well above 10%, even quite easily 15 or 20%. So that's good, but it's not 80% or 90%. The main reason that the efficiency of a solar cell is well below 100% is what we call spectral mismatch losses. This is a schematic of a solar cell. It's a solar cell consists of a semiconductor material, for example, silicon. In semiconductor material, you have a valence band that is filled with electrons. Then there's a band gap. Those are energies that an electron cannot have in that material. And then there's conduction band, again, a broad band of a continuum of energy levels that electrons can have in the material, but all the electrons are filling up the valence band, and the conduction band is empty. Now, if you excite the semiconductor material, silicon, with photons where the energy is higher than the band gap, you can excite electrons from the filled valence band to the empty conduction band, and then you have a high-energy electron, and a high-energy hole is left behind in the valence band. And the semiconductor material is typically sandwiched between a P-type silicon and N-type silicon, and very rapidly the holes in the valence band are captured by the P-type silicon, the electrons in the conduction band are captured by the N-type silicon, and then you have a high-energy electron that has to recombine via an external circuit, generating electrical energy with the hole in the valence band. So that's a basic principle of solar cells that converts energy of photons in energy stored in an electron hole pair that have to recombine through an external circuit. The efficiency is very high for photons that exactly have the energy of the band gap. So when the photon energy is exactly the same as the band gap, then you can just excite an electron from the top of the valence band to the bottom of the conduction band, and they have an electron hole pair, and they can be captured and recombined, have a pretty good energy. But when a photon of a much higher energy, for example, a blue or a UV photon, hits the semiconductor material, you excite an electron somewhere deep in the valence band or somewhere high in the conduction band, and you create a hot electron and a hot hole, and they very quickly relax, giving off the energy into vibrations and heat in your semiconductor. So the efficiency for those photons in the blue and UV part of the spectrum is very low, because the large part of the photon energy is lost in heat. And we call that thermalization losses. When a photon has a wavelength longer than the bandgap of the semiconductor, or an energy lower than the bandgap of the semiconductor, then there's not enough energy for the photon to excite the electron from the valence band to the conduction band. There's simply not enough energy. So those photons are transmitted, and we call that transparency losses. And if you look at the energy efficiency of a solar cell, then in this plot, you have the broad solar spectrum as the sunlight reaches the Earth, from the UV to the infrared. Then the green part is the maximum energy that can be utilized by a silicon solar cell. The silicon solar cell, the bandwidth of silicon, corresponds to photons of 1100 nanometers. All the photons with wavelengths longer than 1100 nanometers are lost. And, well, if you go to higher photon energies, short wavelengths, a larger part of the photon energy is not utilized by the solar cell. Now, those losses can be reduced by using luminescent materials, up and down conversion materials, which convert the photons with the sun. And there's two types of conversions that can be useful. Up conversion, where you convert two infrared photons with a wavelength longer than 1100 nanometer to one photon of a higher energy, so you add up two photons of low energy to one photon of higher energy, that is above the bandwidth of silicon, and then you can gain about 12% of efficiency for the silicon solar cell. Another process you can use is down conversion, where you split one photon of high energy into two photons of lower energy, but still above the bandgap of crystalline silicon. We call it down conversion. So for all photons with a wavelength shorter than 550 nanometers, if you can split those in two photons of lower energy, but still above the bandgap of crystalline silicon, you can gain another 10%. So there's a huge potential for increase of efficiency of solar cells. So first, let's discuss up conversion. So two photons in, one photon out, up conversion, was discovered here in France by François Ozel, famous scientist in my field, the field of lanthanide luminescence. He discovered it in the mid-60s, and he did not publish it in Nature or Science or a high-impact journal. It was not so important in 1965. He published it in Comprendu Hebdomadaire des Sciences de l'Académie des Sciences, Série B. And I was told today that that journal still exists, but I'm not sure what the impact factor is. He published it in French, of course, not in English. French is much more beautiful. And so the title of the article was Compteur quantique par transfert d'énergie entre deux ions de terre rare dans une tungstate et mixte et dans une verre. And also he didn't call it upconversion, because that's also an English word. He called it APTE, addition de photons par transfert d'énergie. This is François Ozel, when he got the ICL prize in 2008. And still, he called it APTE. So the material that François Ozel worked on was not deep infrared to infrared just above the bandwidth of crystalline silicon. He worked on infrared to visible up conversion with the lanthanide ion couple, ytterbium and erbium. So ytterbium has 13 electrons in the 4F shell, almost full, and then you get a very simple energy level scheme, a 2F, 7F ground state, 2F, 5F excited state, around 1,000 nanometers. If you combine that with erbium, that has a more complex energy level structure, 4I, 15F ground state, 4I, 11F excited state, resonant with the 2F, 5F state of erbium, and then many other states, but also an energy level, 4F, 7F, around 20,000 wave numbers. If you combine the two and you excite the ytterbium at 980 nanometers, then ytterbium will transfer energy to erbium. Ytterbium goes down, erbium goes up. And while erbium is still in the excited 4i 11f state, a second ytterbium ion can transfer energy. And then the erbium is raised from the lower excited state 4i 11f to the high excited state 4f 7f, relaxes down to the 4f 3f level, and emits very efficiently nice green light. And now, 50 years later, after this great discovery by François Ozel, it is used in many applications, biolabeling, anti-counterfeiting. Here you can see nanocrystals with the ytterbium-erbium couple. Beautiful green luminescence, exciting infrared. And also, every Chinese banknote has upconversion material in it. If you look at the banknote under regular light, you see this. When you look on the UV light, there's also a normal phosphor that absorbs the UV and emits in the yellow spectral region. But if you excite with an infrared laser at 98 nanometers, you see that same spot emit beautiful green light due to an upconversion phosphor with ytterbium and erbium. Now, we've made rather efficient upconversion materials with an efficiency of about 12%. And we also tested it under real sunlight. And, well, here you see the solar simulator. So we have our solar cell. Sunlight is concentrated because upconversion becomes more efficient when you have higher excitation density because it's a two-photon process. And the light output goes quadratic with the excitation intensity, so we concentrate the sunlight. And here's our upconverted material that we made with the highest efficiency, gallium oxide sulfide. With erbium, has a 12% quantum efficiency. When you focus the sunlight on the solar cell, then part of the sunlight beyond 1100 nanometers is transmitted. It's focused on upconversion material. Upconversion material converts part of the deep infrared light up to 1000 nanometer photons that are reflected back by this white plastic in which it's embedded to the solar cell. And we saw a small increase of about 0.1-0.2% in the efficiency of the solar cell. Not impressive, but it's always good to also test if the idea works. Then the other process, down conversion, splitting one high energy photon into two lower energy photons. There again, many different options are offered by the lanternizer. All those beautiful energy level schemes that I showed before can be utilized to make down conversion materials. And we found a number of couples that are quite efficient, terbium, ytterbium. The terbium ion, this 5D4 level in the green that I showed before in the beginning, 20,000 wave numbers. When you excite ytterbium in the green spectral region, it can transfer the energy in one step to two ytterbium ions that then both emit a photon around 1,000 nanometers. The second couple that we found is praseodymium ytterbium, which relies on a two-step energy transfer process. You excite ytterbium in a high excited state, around 22,000 wave numbers. It relaxes down to the 3P0 level. The energy difference between 3P0 and 1D4 is exactly resonant with the excitation of ytterbium from the ground state to F5Fs. So when you combine praseodymium and ytterbium, you get a two-step energy transfer process. At first, one photon is transferred. One ytterbium emits an infrared photon, 1,000 nanometers. Then the praseodymium is left in the 1D4 state. From there, it can transfer a second energy package to a second ytterbium that also emits. Again, very nice. The problem is that the efficiency of those down-conversion processes is very high, but the absorption of sunlight is very weak. Those lanternizers are very sharp absorption lines, so it only overlaps with a very small part of the solar spectrum. And they are, as I mentioned also in the beginning, forbidden transition. There's no change of dipole, so they have weak absorption in a narrow part of the spectrum. So we still have to solve the absorption problem before we can make solar cells more efficient. So the 22% increase in efficiency is still a dream, but we're working on it. Last application, money. Not unimportant. Here we see some euro banknotes as they came out in 2002. So the Dutch guilders, beautiful banknotes, were gone. The French francs, no longer there. The euro banknotes are quite nice. I like the Dutch guilder bills better. They were more creative and more artistic. But under UV light, the euro banknotes are really more beautiful. This is what at the cash register, when they check if you have a real banknote, what they see at the cash register, they see beautiful luminescence. So under UV radiation of 360 nanometers, you see beautiful red stars, red, blue, and green fibers, beautiful luminescence. And on the other side, you see Europe nicely luminescing in green, still with Great Britain. That may change. So when they came out in January 2002, the first thing we did, we put them in our equipment to measure the luminescence spectra, try to discover what those materials were. Because if you know what those materials were, then you can... No, cannot do that. So this is what we measured. The red stars and the red fibers, beautiful sharp line emission, strong emission around 612 nanometers, very characteristic of europium 3+, and we did more measurements, excitation spectrum, luminescence lifetime, and it's very similar to what we know for the luminescence of europium 3+, in an organic complex, a beta diketone complex. So that is europium 3+, coordinated by three organic molecules with a C double bonded O two canton groups. The green luminescence, very clearly europium 2+, based excitation spectrum, luminescence lifetime, very clearly europium 2+. The host is harder to determine because it's broadband. It's not as characteristic as the sharp line emission, but it's probably europium 2+ in a sulfide or a covalent aluminate. And the blue emission is very similar to the blue phosphor that was used in fluorescent tubes, the barium magnesium illuminators, again, europium 2+. So we measured that, I called with the Dutch National Bank to check if we were correct, if it was europium 3+ and beta diketone, sulfide or covalent illuminate, barium magnesium illuminate. At first I had no clue what I was talking about, but finally some man from the bank called back. It was a man who visited our lab in the late 90s to talk about safeguarding value paper with luminescent materials. And he said, yeah, I don't know what the materials are. So we thought we did know. So we published a nice little article in the magazine of the Chemical Association of the Netherlands. And note the date, February 16, 2002. So 6 weeks after the introduction of the euro. Fastest article ever, because this is not a real scientific article. But and in that article we explained, we showed the spectra, we showed the beautiful pictures on the UV lamp and europium 3+ in the beta diketone complex. After we published this article, the man from the bank called back and he was not upset. He said, actually, I do know what the materials are, but it's a secret. But we thought we knew, so europium 3+ in a diketone, europium 2+ in a sulfide or covalent luminate, europium 2+ in luminate. But one thing he wanted to confirm is that you are correct that indeed all three luminescent materials, the blue, the green, and the red luminescent material, is all europium. And that was no coincidence. Those people of the bank, and usually I think of bank people as somewhat boring, no fantasy, but no, they had a great idea. They thought it was fun to safeguard the euro banknote with the element europium. So that brings me to my conclusions. I hope I've shown that rare earths and rare earth luminescence are very important for a sustainable earth. The magnets in the wind turbines, solar cells, batteries, efficient lamps, catalysis, all those applications where we can go to sustainable earths can really profit from the unique properties of lanthanide ions. As far as optical properties are concerned, lanthanide ions are crucial in high efficiency white light LEDs, fluorescent tubes, X-ray imaging, homeland security, fire communication, anti-counterfeiting, many specific properties that can only be realized by using all those beautiful energy levels that arise from the interaction between the F electrons for the different lanthanides. New applications require new properties, so there's still a challenge for understanding and tailoring luminescence properties, making better, higher efficiency solar cells, higher efficiency white light LEDs, so more research needs to be done. Now, before the chairman comes, I have a chemistry. This is Europe, European Union, and there is some secret information in the periodic table about Europe. This is the periodic table that for chemists like I is, that's our building block for all the materials and that's what we use, the properties. But there's some hidden information about Europe, and that has a little bit to do with France. I showed in the beginning that the Netherlands is a small country, France is big, Germany is big, and in small countries like the Netherlands, Belgium, Denmark, Portugal, we are worried about that. Because when France and Germany agree on something, then that seems to what's happening. And already a long time, when Sarkozy was the president of France, there was this article in Bild, saying, Merkozy, ziet zo dat nooit Europa aus. And now Macron and Merkel, when they seem to discuss something, that's what happens. So for the small countries, we're worried that France and Germany, that's what Europe is, and we don't matter. Now that information that France and Germany are equal to Europe, that information is in the periodic table. If you look at the periodic table, then we see France, gallium, Gallia, next to germanium, Germany, element number 31, element 32, nicely next to each other. Now, if you nuclear fuse element number 31 and element number 32, if you fuse gallium and germanium, France and Germany, you get element number 63. And element number 63 is europium. With that, I'd like to thank you for your attention.